We are back on Exposé. I'm your regular host, Tony Akinyemi. Today we are going to continue on our exposition on cholesterol. I'd like you to at this time quickly invite your friends and your neighbors. Remind them that Exposé has taken off right now. Let them join us for this wonderful episode and they will thank you for it. Last week we looked at the beneficial effects of cholesterol in our lives, in our bodies. And I gave you 8 wonderful benefits of cholesterol. Before now, many people think of cholesterol as a very bad guy. Many people don't know that without cholesterol, life itself cannot be supported. With the episode we had last week, by now I believe you understand how important cholesterol can be in the human body and in our lives. Today we are going to be looking again at some other aspects of this all-important subject. There are other things in our blood that cause more damage for our cardiovascular health than cholesterol. And I'll be dealing with at least 2 of them today. And then subsequently we'll be looking at how to normalize cholesterol levels in our bodies. Or better still, how to prevent the oxidation of cholesterol, which is really the bottom line. The main problem is when cholesterol is oxidized. We will understand what that means, what causes cholesterol oxidation, and how to prevent the oxidation of cholesterol so it doesn't cause these problems in our bodies. Don't go away, I'll be back shortly after this break. Welcome back. This is still Exposé, and I'm your regular host, Tony Akinyemi. Today, we want to begin by looking at the 2 main types of cholesterol. Of course, there are subsets, but these 2 are the main types. We have the low-density lipoprotein, LDL cholesterol, and high-density lipoprotein, or HDL cholesterol. Now, LDL cholesterol is often referred to as the bad cholesterol, while HDL cholesterol is referred to as the good cholesterol. Why are they so named? I'm going to be explaining shortly. But before then, let me say that cholesterol, as we know it in our body, can be measured in our blood. And when you do a simple blood test, it will show you your cholesterol status. But before we go there, we get to that particular portion. Let me talk about why HDL is called good cholesterol and LDL is called bad cholesterol. Now, HDL is that part of cholesterol that mobilizes cholesterol to the liver so that the liver can help in its elimination from our body. And that's why it is called good cholesterol. But LDL cholesterol, on the other hand, mobilizes cholesterol into our arteries where they can be deposited into the arteries, the blood vessels in our bodies, and they can form arterial plaque, arterial deposit. And that deposit can do a number of things. Number one, it can narrow the blood vessel. Number two, it can thicken the blood vessel and make it to lose elasticity. And number three, it can impair blood circulation. And that whole thing, the plaque deposit in the blood vessels, is referred to in medical terms as atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis is plaque deposit in blood vessels, and the chief element in plaque is cholesterol. And when atherosclerosis takes place, the blood vessel becomes narrow, it becomes thick, blood circulation is impaired, the elasticity of the blood vessel is also affected. Our blood vessels are elastic. In other words, they can dilate, they can expand to allow more blood to flow, to make blood pressure to go down. They can also constrict, they can shrink as it were, in order to let BP go up. So that way the body is able to maintain our blood pressure within a certain range. But when the blood vessel loses its elasticity, then it is no longer able to easily regulate blood pressure. That is why it is considered that LDL cholesterol is bad, because it is part of the substances that you find in plaque, in blood vessels. But I'm going to explain why LDL cholesterol is not necessarily bad. Number one is the fact that we should ask the question, Why is it that the body will mobilize LDL cholesterol to deposit in our arteries? The inner layer of our arteries is called the endothelium. And the endothelial cells are the inner cells in our blood vessels. Why does cholesterol or LDL cholesterol deposit in our arteries? That is the big question we should be answering. Now, certain things that enter into our bloodstreams can actually bruise our arterial cells. In other words, the endothelium, the layer of cells in the interior of our arteries, can be bruised or injured by certain things circulating in our blood. And one of those things is what we call anti-caking agents that are usually added to some of the foods, the processed foods that we eat, particularly refined salt. You find that your salt is dry and easy flowing because they have added anti-caking agents. Some of these anti-caking agents act like broken glass, microscopic broken glass. And when you eat those things and they are absorbed into your bloodstream, as they are flowing through the bloodstream, they can actually cause injury to the endothelium or the inner layer of our arteries. And any time there is such an injury, that place can begin to bleed. But the body is very, very intelligent. The body is smart. Whenever there is arterial injury, the body will mobilize LDL cholesterol and other substances to form something like plaster, to plaster that location. Unfortunately, the buildup begins to increase and increase until it forms arterial plaque, and then it results in arteriosclerosis, as well as all the implications of that. Blood vessel thickening, blood vessel narrowing, blood vessel hardening, and the loss of elasticity, and that begins to impair on our cardiovascular health on the long run. Because of the buildup of arterial plaque, people have therefore considered LDL cholesterol as bad cholesterol. But the big question is, if that plaque didn't form, if that plaster was not placed upon that place that was bruised in your endothelium, it is likely that you will have been suffering from internal bleeding, and that could have led to some greater problems many years before now. So the plaster prevented that disaster. But of course, many years down the road, the plaque that is building up can also cause another problem. But it is like, at least the deposit helps you to gain many more years of life before it now culminates in maybe a heart attack or a stroke or sudden death. So, in my view, LDL cholesterol actually plays a very important role as well in our health. So we know the difference between LDL cholesterol and HDL cholesterol. Now, number two area that I want us to look at today is the relationship between cholesterol and cardiovascular diseases. Now, cardiovascular diseases have to do with diseases that affect the heart and the blood vessels. Diseases of the heart, the blood vessels, and the blood also contributes, because when there is thrombosis or blood clot, that can also result in either cardiovascular problems or cerebrovascular problems. Problems in the cardiovascular system or problems in the neurological system. When there's a blood clot, for example, that blocks blood flow to the brain, a person can suffer ischemic stroke, and that is a cerebrovascular accident. Alright? Or when the blood vessel bursts in the brain, that is hemorrhagic stroke, and that is another cerebrovascular accident. So, cholesterol and cardiovascular diseases, what is the connection? First, I'd like you to know that studies have revealed that 50% of people who suffer from cardiovascular disease actually have normal cholesterol level. Half of those who have cardiovascular diseases actually have normal cholesterol levels. So if cholesterol is the one responsible for cardiovascular diseases, how come that 50% of those with cardiovascular diseases have normal cholesterol levels? There is a puzzle there that we need to unravel today. This is the whole essence of exposé. Number two, I want you to understand that low cholesterol numbers can give you a false sense of security. If you do your blood cholesterol check and everything looks normal, that may make you feel that, wow, everything is okay, I don't have any problem. That may be a false sense of security, because the fact that somebody's blood cholesterol is low does not mean that the person may still not experience some cardiovascular challenges or heart disease. I'm going to be getting to that as we go on. Number three, I want you to understand that low cholesterol is only one part of the whole puzzle. It's only one part of the cholesterol puzzle. And we'll see the remaining part of the puzzle. There are other elements like homocysteine and fibrin, which I'll be touching upon. Number four, cholesterol itself is not the problem. The cholesterol becomes a problem when it becomes oxidized. In other words, when an atom of oxygen is added to the structure of cholesterol, cholesterol is a kind of waxy fat, and when an atom of oxygen is added to it, it becomes oxycholesterol. So it is that oxycholesterol or oxidized cholesterol that actually is responsible for cardiovascular problems as we know it. And number five, homocysteine, an amino acid, is that substance that actually oxidizes cholesterol and converts it to oxycholesterol. Homocysteine is spelled HOMOCYSTEINE, homocysteine. It is a protein, an amino acid, that comes from the proteinous foods that we eat, particularly animal protein. That is where homocysteine is formed from. So we get on now to homocysteine. I will still come back later, maybe today if time permits, or in a subsequent episode, to show you how to normalize your cholesterol levels. But since I have established that cholesterol itself is not the main issue, other things are the main issues when it comes to cardiovascular health. Number one, the oxidation of cholesterol is an issue. Number two, the amino acid homocysteine that causes the oxidation of cholesterol is an issue. Number three, there is fibrin, which increases blood stickiness. That is also an issue. Of course, there's another issue called Lp(a). If time permits, we may be able to get to that. And then there is also another fat, another lipid in our blood that is called triglycerides. All of these combined together form different aspects of the total picture when it comes to cardiovascular health. Unfortunately, cholesterol has been singled out of all of these guys, and it has been given a bad rap and a bad name. That's why today many people are running away from fat or fatty food, not understanding that there are two major types of fats. We have good fats and we have bad fats. We'll be dealing with details of that in another episode. But today, I want to touch on homocysteine, the amino acid that converts cholesterol to oxidized cholesterol or oxycholesterol. Now, homocysteine is made by the human body from another amino acid that is called methionine. Methionine, that is the name of the amino acid. It comes from our proteinous food. When you eat meat, you eat chicken, you eat turkey, you eat egg, and what have you, you have methionine as part of the amino acids that will come out of the digestion of that protein. And the body can then use that methionine to form homocysteine, another form of amino acid. Now, that homocysteine is supposed to be a precursor. In other words, a raw material that your body will use to manufacture some super antioxidants in your body. But when all the other cofactors, all the other ingredients that your body needs to combine with homocysteine to make those antioxidants are absent in your diet, then the homocysteine begins to perform another function that the body did not intend for it to perform. It begins to interact with cholesterol and begins to oxidize cholesterol and make cholesterol to become dangerous. Okay? It was Dr. Kilmer McCauley, a medical doctor, an MD, who first of all suggested in the year 1969 that elevated homocysteine level in the blood is actually the main culprit in heart disease and not cholesterol. Of course, he was vilified and castigated and attacked by his colleagues, medical doctors like him, that he was preaching heresy. But today, science knows better, that homocysteine is actually the culprit in cardiovascular diseases and not cholesterol. Okay? According to Dr. Kilmer McCauley, a medical doctor, he says high blood levels of homocysteine is an objective indicator and a risk factor in many diseases, particularly chronic degenerative diseases, and he lists the following diseases as possible outcomes of high-level, uncontrolled amount of homocysteine in the blood. He says it's an objective indicator and risk factor for heart attacks, strokes, cancer, diabetes, thyroid problems, Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, depression, infertility, chronic pain, and digestive disorders. High level of homocysteine in the blood is a risk factor and an objective indicator for all of those conditions listed, according to Dr. Kilmer McCauley. Now, homocysteine converts to two major super antioxidants in the body. One is S-adenosine methionine, otherwise known as SAMe, capital S, capital A, capital M, and small letter E, or SAMe, S-adenosyl methionine. And the second super antioxidant that homocysteine converts to in the body is called glutathione. Glutathione. These two super antioxidants perform wonderful things in our bodies to help us to neutralize free radicals. Free radicals are rogues in the body that cause oxidative damage, rapid aging, and degeneration in our body. But these antioxidants help to neutralize these free radicals. And the body manufactures them from these this protein called homocysteine. So you have S-adenosyl methionine and glutathione. Now, specifically, apart from being an antioxidant, SAMe also performs three major functions in the body, among others. Number one, it prevents depression, arthritis, and liver damage. S-adenosyl methionine, that homocysteine is converted to, actually helps to prevent those conditions. Number two, it is also a detoxifying agent. It helps the liver to remove toxins or waste products from the body so they don't damage the body. Number three, it is equally an anti-aging agent. Of course, anything that neutralizes free radicals can be considered an anti-aging agent. But then, for homocysteine in the blood to be converted to S-adenosyl methionine or to glutathione, certain cofactors must be present. Certain nutrients must be present in your diet. For homocysteine to convert to SAMe, you must have folate in your diet. You must have vitamin B2 in your diet. You must have vitamin B12 in your diet. You must have zinc in your diet. You must have magnesium in your diet. You must have TMG in your diet. TMG comes from choline, and TMG stands for trimethylglycine. And all of these are amino acids that your body will combine together as if your body wants to prepare a soup. Okay? In this part of the world, we will need something like tomato, like onions, like pepper, and salt, and oil, and this and that to make our soup. Right. The body also needs all of these nutrients to make glutathione and S-adenosyl methionine, super antioxidants. So if you eat protein and you lack these vitamins and minerals, then your body is not able to convert homocysteine to these antioxidants. So homocysteine continues to float in your blood, and then it interacts with cholesterol and oxidizes cholesterol. For your body to convert homocysteine into glutathione, your body needs at least three nutrients to perform that function or to synthesize glutathione. Homocysteine comes from methionine, which comes from protein. So like you eat a piece of protein right now, your body digests the protein, breaks it down into several amino acids, one of which is methionine, and then your body will convert the methionine to homocysteine, and that homocysteine is a precursor ingredient for becoming glutathione. Now, your body needs three nutrients to convert homocysteine to glutathione. It needs vitamin B2, vitamin B6, and zinc. Vitamin B2, vitamin B6, and zinc. When those three nutrients are present in your diet, your body will use it to combine with homocysteine to make glutathione. And glutathione is a super antioxidant. It is an anti-aging agent. It neutralizes free radicals. It prevents cancer in that regard. Okay. Now, so if the above nutrients that I have mentioned, like zinc, magnesium, vitamin B2, vitamin B6, vitamin B12, TMG, and all of these are absent in your diet, then homocysteine cannot be converted. And if homocysteine is not converted into those super antioxidants, it begins to cause damage to your cholesterol and makes it very, very dangerous. Now, so these are what homocysteine will cause in your body if you don't convert them to super antioxidants. Number one, homocysteine itself can speed up oxidation in the body because it increases the amount of free radicals circulating around your body, because there's nothing to neutralize those free radicals. Number two, there is accelerated aging when you have high level of homocysteine in your blood. Number three, it can increase plaque deposit, thereby leading to atherosclerosis. Number four, it increases the rate at which your blood clots, so it can lead to blood clots or thrombosis, which can lead to strokes or heart attacks. Number five, it leads to low nitric oxide in the blood. Nitric oxide is a gas in the blood that helps blood vessels to expand, to dilate, so that blood pressure can come down. So when you have high homocysteine, there will be low nitric oxide. Number six, high homocysteine can cause inflammation and pain. And number seven, high homocysteine can also culminate in low immunity. So you see why homocysteine must not be allowed to be high in your blood. Now, how then do you lower homocysteine in the blood? That to me is more important than lowering cholesterol. I'm going to give you 10 simple tips today on how to lower homocysteine level, or how to normalize homocysteine level in your blood. Of course, as long as you are consuming protein, you will have homocysteine in your blood. And you do need those amino acids. You need them, because without them, you cannot make those super antioxidants. So you need to add all the ingredients needed to convert homocysteine to super antioxidants. So quickly, 10 ways to ensure that you lower homocysteine in your blood. Number one, eat only healthy fats. Don't eat bad fats. I'm going to come to that in another episode to explain good fats and bad fats. But for today, omega-3 oil is good fat. Avocado is good fat. Coconut oil is good fat. Olive oil is good fat. Avocado oil is good fat. Fried oil, trans fat, is bad fat. Margarine is bad fat, and so on and so forth. Number two, to lower your homocysteine, you need to make raw vegetables a major part of your meals. At least 50% of what you eat every day should be raw food. Number three, eat high-quality plant protein. That will lower the amount of homocysteine in your blood. Number four, avoid alcoholic beverages. Number five, reduce stress in your life, or manage your stress appropriately. Number six, don't smoke tobacco. Number seven, avoid refined salt that contains anti-caking agents. Use Himalayan pink salt or Celtic sea salt moderately in your cooking rather than refined salt that has anti-caking agents. Number eight, exercise moderately but regularly. Number nine, supplement with vitamins and minerals, particularly the ones needed to convert homocysteine to antioxidants. All right, things like B vitamins, zinc, magnesium, TMG, these are supplements that will help to lower your homocysteine. And number 10, avoid junk foods. Okay, another thing that also affects the stickiness or the sluggishness of our blood, the stickiness of our blood and the sluggishness of our blood circulation, is called fibrin. Fibrin is another bigger problem than cholesterol. I have emphasized or underscored the fact that homocysteine is a bigger problem than cholesterol. The second thing that is a bigger problem than cholesterol is fibrin. Now, fibrin is a main clotting factor. Too much fibrin can impede blood circulation in our bodies.